Today I want to talk about a somewhat hipster trade war. The trade war with Japan. Yeah, these Chinese tariffs are too mainstream. It feels like it's lost all its heart and just gotten so commercial recently. Now I know what you're thinking. Oh no, a trade war with Japan. Now where am I gonna get a car or a weirdly sexualized figurine? Well, the topics that are currently on the table are cars, agriculture, and money. So at the end of these scheduled trade negotiations, we're either gonna end up with a deal or a country song. Japan is America's fourth largest trading partner behind China and our neighbors to the north and south, Canada and Mexico. And before we get into the talks that just happened between Japan's Prime Minister and our trade representative Lighthizer, we need to get a little backstory, as up to this point I have never talked about the trade war with Japan. This story begins just over 2 years ago, on January 23rd, 2017.
Now that President Donald Trump has formally withdrawn the United States from the 12-nation Trans-Pacific Partnership Trade Agreement, what happens next?
We were out of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, and just like that, we had no trade deals with many of the other 11 countries we were previously negotiating with. Now, we said we were going to negotiate one-on-one bilateral trade agreements with all those countries, but then we saw something shiny and left that project on the top of the fridge. So what recently changed? Well, after we left the TPP, America was jazzed about getting this bilateral trade deal hashed out with Japan. But Japan wasn't exactly the biggest fan of one-on-one trade deals with us. You see, to say history tends to repeat itself would be an understatement in this case. Back in the 1980s, America was terrified of Japan taking all our jobs. There were massive trade deficits working against us, and people were starting to get really worried. Enter Deputy Trade Representative Robert Lighthizer, or some other generic-looking guy who looks like a Sims character before you make any changes. You get a picture shaking the president's hand and you don't retouch it at all? Glad we had the Bigfoot guy documenting that momentous occasion. Now most of you are probably thinking to yourselves, oh, a deputy trade representative by the name of Lighthizer under the Reagan administration. Why is Stephen spending so much time on him? Well, it's because he's back for a rematch. It was just reported that
bilateral talks with Japan made headway this week. The Minister of Economic Revitalization is in D.C. meeting with Ambassador Lighthizer.
Yeah, now he's our full-time trade representative. Congrats on the promotion. So keep that in mind when we're talking about this negotiation that happened back in the 80s. For now though, let's make Trump's ultimate wish come true and go back to the 80s. Our strategy for dealing with Japan back then was twofold. First, Lighthizer pressured Japan to reduce steel and auto exports to the US with punitive tariffs and quotas. It was the 80s, you could still do things like that. Who at the WTO was gonna get on the phone and tell America not to? Russia? Second, Lighthizer launched a series of trade investigations against Japan, leading to the US dollar's depreciation against the Japanese yen. Basically, this made their exports more expensive on the open market. It's all a bit complicated, but for the purposes of this episode, just know we're filing this under dick move. This one-two punch led to a huge drop in exports from Japan, and directly led to the asset bubble that did more damage to Japan in the 1990s than Godzilla. All this accumulated, and earlier this year, a senior member of the Bank of Japan, which is the Japanese Fed, giving China one piece of advice. Avoid one-on-one talks with the US, and keep away from numerical trade targets. So this, of course, brings us back to today, and the question of why not follow your own one piece of advice? For that, we have to get out our handy-dandy calendar and do a little more digging.
There's growing international backlash against President Trump's tariffs. 11 countries have signed a sweeping trade deal that challenges the president's move. This includes major U.S. allies like Canada, Japan, and Australia.
On March 9th, the U.S. did what could only be interpreted as a throwback to the 80s. Pop on that neon. When Trump broadly painted these steel and aluminum tariffs across the globe, one of the countries that got splattered was Japan. This was definitely irksome, but if that was it, we would not be having this report today. In July, Japan hit back by, well, ignoring the United States and signing a free trade deal with Europe.
The European Union and Japan have signed one of history's biggest ever free trade deals.
Now you might see that and think, free trade is a sucker's bet, tariffs and protectionism. But remember, Japan is the fourth largest importer of our goods. So if they have free trade with Europe and expensive trade with us, well, that's not going to be good for our exports. The specific concern here is agriculture, because US farmers risk losing their 22% share of Japan's food import market to rivals with lower tariffs. So we were pretty devastated to see that we had dumped Japan 2 years ago and they moved on with their lives and started to work with other people. I thought we had something special. This led to the Trump response of...
President Trump raising the prospect of slapping a 25% tariff on imported cars.
Japan only agreed to the talks in September after Trump hit Japan's steel and aluminum exports with punitive tariffs and then threatened to impose levies of as much as 25% on all imported cars, including those made in Japan. Now we're here though, with Trump trying to protect agricultural exports to Japan and Japan trying to protect automobile exports to America. Because that's literally a third of the stuff they send us. This brings us to a deal that feels like it should be easy enough to figure out. Corn for cars. Just sign here. Where's my check? Things become a little more complicated with two things. First, unlike Japan's exports to the US, US exports to Japan are really across the spectrum. I mean, the single largest thing we send them are gas turbines. So yeah, pretty hard to pinpoint one industry. Trump has two pushes that he's trying to get Japan to agree to. First, he wants to increase the sale of American cars in Japan, because that currently makes up 1% of our exports to them. And, well, Chevy isn't working on a car people want anytime soon, so we need to find some place to sell that stuff. Automobiles are the largest trade deficit industry between the US and Japan, so we decided to attack that area. Because why not find the one industry where another country is clearly having more success than you and try to fight them on that? Some people would say it kind of feels like trying to sell cookies to the Girl Scouts. The other big issue we're encountering right now is...
What do you think is the issue here? There's a lot of talk about currency, but certainly there are other issues as well.
Yes, I actually don't think currency is a very important issue between the United States and Japan. Japan's not what I would term a currency manipulator.
Currency is playing an oddly large part in these negotiations. Specifically, Japan doesn't want a currency clause in the agreement, while America does. Remember, back in the 1980s, there was that 1-2 punch of restricting exports and artificially strengthening the Japanese currency. Well, Japan remembers. Japan's concerned that any currency clause would give ground to the US to criticize the Bank of Japan's ultra-loose monetary policy. On the other hand, US Treasury Secretary Steve Mnuchin has said that the US wants any trade deal with Japan to include language that would prevent competitive devaluations, currency moves designed specifically to boost exports. Just know that Japan's economy has been stalled since, well, the mid-90s. Wow, Lighthizer did a good job leveling off that growth. For comparison, here's America over that same period. Remember that terrible recession in 2008? Don't you feel like that rich kid complaining that the vending machine won't accept his $100 bills right about now? Now some of that definitely stems from an aging workforce and a shrinking population, but still, yeah, they're in an economic stimulation mode right now. When a country's trying to stimulate their economy, a side effect of that is a devaluation of their currency. And if America succeeds on this issue, Japan would probably have to constantly justify stimulus as fighting these recessions that, well, if they were happening in the US, we'd be reporting on it as if it was end times, as opposed to boosting exports. Basically, it seems like we've convinced Japan that it's better than the alternative to negotiate a one-on-one trade deal with us. And once we decide how much that deal benefits our auto industry and whether we can use the deal to regulate Japan's currency value, we'll have something that Trump can waive for 2020. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the left of my head. ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.